in your hand to the point that we just got down here and footed this account? What could have happened? In other words, if we're keeping books by hand, or even if we're not, even if we're doing it in a computerized accounting system, this balance right here that we actually get at the end of a cycle of accounting transactions is only as good as the person behind the pencil or the computer entering those transactions. Would you agree with that? I mean, it's just, we opened up ourselves to a ton of errors that even if the balance based upon the debits and credits is accurately computed, that doesn't mean that every debit that went into this account or every credit that went into this account was accurately inputted. Because, as again, as humans, we are notorious for making mistakes. We transpose numbers. Maybe we enter the same transaction twice. Maybe we didn't enter something at all. All of these things can create errors in the balance of cash or in other accounts as well. If you omit the cash side of a transaction or incorrectly debit or credit cash, then chances are you incorrectly debited or credited another account as well. If your system remained in balance, debits equal credits. So how do we determine then, what would be another good checkpoint? Remember, accounting is full of checks and balances along the way. Debits have to equal credits here in the journal, they have to equal in the ledger, and then our trial balance has to equal then all of our financial statements, et cetera, et cetera. So if we get through all of that process and everything is perfectly puzzle pieced together and it all looks good, how do we know what do you think another deciding point would be that, yes, this is a 99.9% chance of being accurate because we have tied this also to what? In other words, remember that this cash account will eventually show up on the balance sheet, our final financial statement, in that we're going to list all of our assets, cash, supplies, accounts receivable, et cetera, et cetera. And the people looking at that balance sheet want to know, how confident are you that this cash that came from here and you posted here into your balance sheet or moved to the balance sheet financial statement, how confident are you that that is accurate? So what are you going to say? Oh, well, I went back and checked all my adding and subtracting. Well, that's good, as long as you did what? As long as you had entered everything correctly. So what do you think then is us as an accountant, what outside entity or what outside kind of checkpoint could I have to check myself? Because you can only check yourself so many times, and then eventually you're just looking at the same numbers over and over again and you don't find mistakes and it looks good to you and you know you're tired and you got to move on to the next step. The bank statement. Because everything that we've entered as a debit in this account and everything that we've entered as a credit should also be reflected on the bank statement at some point in time. We will have some timing differences depending on when we run this balance versus the bank statement because they're not always going to be on the same day. But the bank statement is just nothing more than a report from the bank that says this month, and the banks are required by law to issue a bank statement to their customers once every 30 days, at least one time every 30 days, whereby they report everything that has been debited or credited out of that bank account. And I don't want to use the word debit and credit necessarily. They report everything that has been deposited to that account and everything that has been deducted from that account for the last 30 days. And then your job as an accountant is to look at that bank statement and make sure that everything the bank shows is accurate. In other words, they didn't take money maybe from your account to put it into somebody else's by accident. And it does happen. Banks do make mistakes. But as far as errors are concerned, we, the consumer of the bank statement, or excuse me, of the bank account, usually make a lot more errors than the bank does. They do make them, but not nearly on the same level that we make them as humans, because they're just going by electronic type things that, unless somebody inputs a wrong account number, you're just not going to see a lot of errors in your bank statement. But they do happen. So it's our job as the accountant to once a month open up that bank statement and compare it to this. This is what we've done. Does it match what the bank statement reflects? And that's our job. So on, if you have, let's see if I can get this one to show up here. This is just a bank statement on page 237 if you have a physical book. Otherwise, it's figure 7-5 in chapter 7. And it's a very simplified picture of, this is what a bank statement might look like from, say, Wizard Bank, or this is from Maple Consulting. And basically, you can see the information that a bank statement is giving us. It's telling us, the bank says we had $2,721.51 at the end of the last cycle, which would become the beginning of this cycle. And during the last 30 days, we have you made two deposits to the bank, and they totaled $25.99.31, and we paid 17 checks out of your, or withdrawals out of your account that totaled $35.72.73. So therefore, at the end of this month, you have $1,748.09. And so it's our job as accountants to make sure that that is accurate. Did they deposit the right amount of money? Did they withdraw the right amount of money? And the only way we're going to be able to do that is go through all the individual transactions that you see here on the bank statement and check them against our records. And that's what we mean by reconciling a bank statement. Because chances are our balance right here at the end of the month is not going to be $1,748.09. Well, why not? If I didn't make any mistakes and the bank didn't make any mistakes, why would my balance on November 21st, 2021, we'll say, why would my balance be different from the bank's balance on the same day?
Charges, you might have a little bit of an increase and a little of a inflation of interest.
Yeah.
There is no interest.
Yeah. What?
Oh, they also take a while to
close something. Right. We've got two primary issues. Number one, the bank might deduct from us things that we didn't know about until today when we opened the bank statement. Or they could have added a little bit of interest if we have an interest-bearing checking account and we don't know about it until we open up the bank statement. And of course, we know this is all subjective to the fact that none of us go online and check a bank account. Well, we know that times have changed and most everyone does go online on at least an occasional basis and look for those kinds of things. But the big thing is that when this statement, then when this paper cut statement is cut, or you go to your bank and you download the most recent bank statement, on this date of here, November the 21st, there could have been some outstanding items. And what we mean by that is we wrote some checks, and nobody writes checks anymore, I get that, but in businesses they still do. And they write those checks, put them in the mail sometimes, and it may take 2 or 3 weeks before that, these days with mail, right? It could take 2 or 3 weeks before that check actually clears your bank account, meaning before the bank actually takes the money away from you because it's still in the mail out there. But the bank doesn't know that. They're just reporting what? They're reporting what has happened that they know about in your bank statement that has been presented to the bank for payment, if it was a check, or as a deposit because you took it to the teller or you made a picture on your phone and deposited, whatever the case is. So the bank statement is just a tool, but we do have to make adjustments because we have a lag time period that they may cut it, and that's by cutting it, we mean they may print this or cut off the time frame that they're going to report here on November 21, but it may be 5 days before you ever get this thing, or maybe even longer. I have clients that some of their bank statements come directly to me, and they're cut off at the end of every month to run that statement, and I don't ever have that in my hands until about the 10th of every month. Mm-hmm. And it's getting slower and slower. So a lot of things have happened in the last 10 days, haven't they? And we just don't know about it, or same thing, the bank hadn't paid it yet. So we do what we call reconciling the bank statement, in that we're going to look at what our figure, you know, we just said that the bank over here said that this consulting company had approximately $1,700 in the bank. Well, what if we're showing that we have like $2,500 in the bank? Then we need to figure out what's the discrepancy, because, and it's really only for one reason, we're not necessarily consumed with timing differences. We know that checks take longer to mail, et cetera. Maybe we went to the bank after 3 o'clock that day to make a deposit. Well, the bank cut them off at 3 o'clock that day, and it's not showing up on the bank statement. What we're really concerned with is to make sure that we can figure out why there is a difference between us and the bank, and make sure it's not because we made an error or because the bank made an error. Okay? And that's just the main reason that we do this, is to check ourselves. It's like the ultimate checkpoint in our system, that if our bank reconciliation, if we can get our balance in the bank to tie to the bank's balance in the bank, minus an addition, adding and subtracting some differences because of timing, if we can get those things reconciled. And what does the word reconcile mean?
To make right.
Or to make one, you know, to come to an agreement, right? You're going to make it right by coming to an agreement. And we've got to figure out what is it that will make us come to this agreement between them showing us $1,700 and us reflecting $2,500. We've got to figure out what is that difference, to make sure it's not because we omitted something, we failed to record a check or deposit, etc. So we do the bank reconciliation, and so we're just going to kind of take some numbers and work with it. It's a lot easier to kind of talk about it with numbers, as we've discovered, keeping in mind that in this particular course, and this is not the way it is in real life, but in this course, we're going to act like the bank never makes an error. So keep that in mind, that if you come across a question on your test or your quiz or your homework, and one of the options for your answer is bank error of X amount of dollars, that's not going to be the right answer in this course. For whatever reason, the book has chosen to ignore the fact that banks do make errors. All the errors that you see discussed in homework, quizzes, etc., are what we call book errors. Us, the accountant, we're making them. Okay, so let's talk about how we basically start a bank reconciliation. And this is just my illustration. You can do it any way you want to on your own, but to kind of give you an idea of what we're actually trying to do, we've got a bank balance and we've got a book balance of what is in our account. And again, 99.9% of the time, unless you have very few transactions in a bank account, what our balance on the bank for cash, our book balance, is not going to be the same as for the bank balance. So the first thing we're going to look for is those outstanding items. We, as the keepers of the books, the theory is that we have recorded everything that happened. But what is it about the bank that would make their balance different, because they don't know about everything that we've done? And if you've read the chapter, and I would of course encourage you to do so, we have what we call deposits in transit. And all that means is that we have gone to the bank and made a deposit, and we have recorded it in our books. But the bank doesn't know about it yet on the day that they're cutting that statement. It's not showing up in the bank statement. because we went again after, say, 3 o'clock. And the bank has to have a cutoff time. You know, if you've ever gone through a teller window, even in years past, maybe, or maybe even when you make deposits on your phone, they give you a time that if you're making this deposit after a certain time frame, what's going to happen?
Rolls the next day.
Goes over
business
to the next day. Yeah. The next business day is when you'll see it in your bank account as being available to spend. They just got to have these cutoffs in time, especially these days. So we will add any deposits in transit to the balance that the bank is reporting on a bank statement. We're going to add them because they just don't know about them yet, or they may know about them, but they're not being reflected on this particular bank statement that we're looking at. Then there's another phrase that we use, outstanding checks. What is an outstanding check? I know y'all are writing. Yeah, has it cleared the bank yet? I'm a paper person. I love checks. I don't write a lot of them anymore, but I do because you can write all kinds of things on that check. You use your debit card or you have it just drafted or whatever. Limited information, right, as far as your visual is concerned. A check is all there. But when companies do write checks, and again, they still do, if the person you sent it to, maybe they were on vacation, and so they're not even going to open it for another 2 weeks. In that case, then, the bank is going to still, they're required by law, on the, let's say, the last day of the month, they're required to send you a statement of everything that they processed for the month out of your account. And in hindsight, they don't know that you've mailed checks to the landlord or to the utility company or whoever, and that they haven't even opened it yet. They can't report anything on the bank statement that they have not been presented for payment. So outstanding checks then, because we have written them and we have recorded them on our book to the bank statement balance, excuse me, we will deduct those checks. Why would we need to do that? Just because the bank doesn't know about them, does it affect the fact that we have written them and they're out there in Never Never Land for the moment, and they could present them at any point in time, couldn't they? And we've got to make sure we've got what? We got to have money in the bank to cover them, don't we? And that, if all the things that new age banking, if you want to call that, has messed with my brain, is the fact that I write such few checks anymore, that when I do write one, I forget that I did it, because I'm not keeping the formal check register that, you know, we should all keep now and then. And I forget that I've written these checks, and, you know, it's come to bite me in the tail a couple of times because I'm like, wow, I completely forgot to write that check, you know, 6 months ago when somebody just cashed it or whatever. So outstanding checks are a big deal. If you're going to write checks, you've got to be recording them somewhere regularly and keeping on top of it. Remember when specifically my son, when he turned 16 and started trying to teach him a few things about this, that, and the other, went and opened a little bank account, and I told him, now every month you're going to get this bank statement, and you're going to open it, and you're going to check it, and, you know, go down and check off everything that, you know, you've done here, there, and the other. And he, I just remember very specifically, he looked at me, and he just said, no, that's not going to happen. And he was right. I don't think to this day he's ever gotten a bank statement, much less open it. And But of course, he's on his phone every day looking at his bank account. So, but that's just what we live in, isn't it? Nobody opens them anymore. But a business has to. Why do you think a business is a little bit more...
open?
Yeah.
Perhaps because... my guess is that because... Well, for one, perhaps they make sure you're in line with their policies?
Could be. But remember, what are we ultimately going to do with
We're
our...
We're trying to reconcile the books.
Yeah, we need to reconcile our books. We need to make sure we haven't missed anything. Because ultimately, what are we going to do with these books that we've been keeping all year long? Let's say, you know, we're approaching now, and unfortunately, the end of 2021. What's going to start happening pretty quickly in 2022?
You're going to get one for that last couple of weeks in January, and then another one for the for December 21, and then another one. Coming up pretty quick, right? January 1, 22.
Right. But ultimately, what are we going to use all of our books for? What are we going to, where are we going to report all these numbers? Besides just to ourselves, what have we got to do in spring of 2022?
File
taxes. We've got to file a tax return. And the IRS, in case you don't know this, and most people don't because the IRS does very few audits anymore, but could happen that it's going to start getting a lot heavier in the years to come now, picking back up audits again. If you get audited, if you're a small business or large business or personal, if you get audited, the IRS, the first thing that they're going to do, if it's not just a simple what we call letter audit where they're checking one specific item on a tax return, but if they do in the old days when we did full-blown audits of everything that happened, the first thing that they required you to do when you showed up for an audit is to bring all of your what? What do you think? What? Well, yeah, they'd want those too, but they want all of your bank statements for the year.
Used to. Now, last time I used my brother, he said, I don't want to look at your bank statements.
Yeah. Well, in an audit. I'm talking about a full-fledged IRS audit, not just doing your tax return. But if the IRS suspects anything, the first thing they're going to want to do is all of your bank statements. Because why? They know that what? That the majority, and I use that very lightly these days, the majority of all business transactions for a legitimate business is going to go through a bank account. And if you haven't recorded it properly or misrecorded, et cetera, they're going to be able to find that out through what we call a bank audit. They're going to go through your bank statements, and they're going to take your books, and they're going to compare every check the bank paid, every deposit the bank recorded, against what you've said happened in the actual books. Okay? And when I say books, I'm talking about our accounting records. Okay? So what is this big deal if you watch the news at all? If any of y'all are any aware, in the new legislation that's in the middle of trying to be passed, one of the big controversial things is that the Congress is wanting to pass legislation that would make all banks report to the IRS every transaction, deposit or deduction, in the value of $600 or more out of your bank account. Why do they want to do that? I mean, I have my own theory about why.
That's it, or
in other words, these days, still, our bank accounts are our primary ways of doing business. You know, unless you're literally just dealing with physical cash in your hand and buying supplies with cash and selling for cash, you've ultimately got to have a bank that's going to be like the intermediary. Agreed? And especially if you're a larger business. You don't just go around passing around thousands of dollars of cash back and forth between people. Legitimately. Okay? So the IRS, the government, wants full access to all of your stuff.
But a claim is to try to stop offshoring of people's accounts to the Caribbean to not have to pay taxes or taxes.
Yeah, that.
You and I, or I know I and my classmates here, and the average Joe American, don't have access to these high-powered accountants and lawyers that they have.
Yeah, it's all messed up. No doubt about it. I mean, I can't even get into the politicization of it because, you know, well, first of all, I probably had the stroke because my blood pressure goes up so much. But it really, what goes on in our bank accounts, you know, that's, to me, that's like a fundamental freedom. That's my business. That's not your business. And if I'm going to cheat on my taxes, come and find me. Type of thing. If you think that's what I'm going to do, then you figure it out some way. And they do have great ways of doing this. There was, I like to share this story because it's so interesting to me that it really, what they have done in the past really did work, and it really highlighted a lot of different things. But none of y'all were even born when this happened, probably. But many years ago, there was when Reese Air Force Base was still in operation, mm-hmm. there was, they had a small accounting department, and one of the fellows out there that worked in the accounting department, he was living at the time what was like the neighborhood in Lubbock to live in, Lake Ridge Country Club. And he had like 10 different luxury vehicles. His children went to private school, and his wife didn't work. So, all the neighbors, just out of probably just pure jealousy, my guess, you know, nobody likes to see your neighbor with more than you've got, right? And so they're like, how's this guy, he's an accountant for the government, Reese, of course, governmental entity, and they've got 10 random luxury vehicles that he would trade out every week because he had them stored at an off-site location. Again, kids going to private school. How is he affording this? And that's what we called in the day, and that they still have him, it triggered a lifestyle audit because a few neighbors literally turned him in or turned them in to the IRS because they thought they were evading taxes somehow. That a lifestyle audit looks at your lifestyle, how are you living, and then looks at the income that you're reporting, and if the two don't kind of match up, what do you think that triggers? Yeah, like, well, how do you have all these expenses and this, you know, $500,000 house, but yet you're making $75,000 a year? It just doesn't add up, does it? And so the IRS audited, and he was reporting every dollar of income. And, of course, his lifestyle didn't match it, but they could not detect anything going through his bank account as to potential fraudulent underreporting of income. So they brought in the DEA. I mean, this is kind of like a movie we watch these days, right? Like the Ozarks or, you know, whatever that movie is. Is that what it's called? I mean, all these movies, Breaking Bad, you know, all of them. I love those shows. I don't know what, there's something wrong with me that I love all those shows because I guess it's just my mind thinking, how do these people even think of this stuff and how they get away with it? But anyway, so they called in the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Agency, thinking, okay, they're dealing drugs and they're living off the cash and, you know, they've got all this cash going around town. And so they followed him for like a year, him and his family. And at the conclusion, it was like, these people aren't doing anything. These are the most boring people we've ever met in our life. That is not what's going on. There's no drugs involved. There's nothing. And so they went back then to bank accounts and stuff, and they found an entity that he was involved with that he was actually basically embezzling from the Air Force by charging. He had created an entity out in California and was billing from California to the Air Force for supplies and materials that were never being purchased. But yet he was getting the bills paid and going out to this bank account in California. Anyway, all that to say that it all started because the lifestyle didn't match the wages that were being reported on the tax return. And so, again, the first thing that happened was confiscation of all of his banking records, because that's where it starts. And that's where businesses have to be able to prove this is what's coming in and this is what's going out. And the bank statements are our ultimate test of that. So, again, the bank balance that when we open it up, there's only a couple of things that can possibly be adjusted to them, and that is things that they don't know about, deposits in transit or outstanding checks. And then one final thing that I already said would not happen in this class, but the bank does, on occasion, in real life, make an error, and they can be added or subtracted depending on what they do to their balance. We're not going to affect our balance because we didn't make the error. Agreed? You make the error, then you adjust your books. I'm not adjusting my books for your error. Okay? Now, to the books balance, there's all kinds of things, unlimited amount of things that we may have to adjust for. First of all, our errors, book errors. If we make errors, this is the place we're going to find them. And that's usually 90% of the time. If we're not in balance, and we've adjusted for deposits in transit and outstanding checks, these days, again, the majority of the time, it's because we have made an error in the books, okay? But also, like we talked about, we may need to add that interest income that we earned for the month. We may need to subtract a bank service charge that we just found out about, because we don't go online every day. We just open that bank statement. How about we had a customer write us a hot check? Then if we hadn't already been notified, we're going to find out about it today when we open up the bank statement, because the bank is not going to cover that customer, are they? If we deposit a check to the bank that doesn't clear, you know, from our customer, they're going to come and take it right back away from us, aren't they? And say, sorry, that check that you just deposited wasn't any good. And then there's several other things. Like I said, the list can go on and on. So we're going to put some actual numbers to this to reflect that literally a bank reconciliation is just simply on another piece of paper, or if you've ever looked at a bank statement on the back side, they usually on an original one that comes from the bank. There's a place that they give you to make these adjustments so that you can kind of figure out what's going on. But we're just going to make it real simple. Mine have always been super simple. I literally created two columns. This is what the bank's showing. This is what I'm showing now. Let me start trying to figure out where are the discrepancies. Why do I not have the same balance? So in your homework, I'm sure you're going to get to the one that you almost always include in your homework. Let's say 8A. I'm on page 257 if you happen to have a book, or if you go back and do this later on. And the way they're going to be set up, and it'll probably look like this on the exams that you're taking, stuff like that. They give you the information about a particular company as far as balances are concerned. Then they start listing out different items and what they reflect. And then they want you to figure out, well, why are those balances different? So this was for Johnson Enterprises as of October 31st. So again, like I said, I'm going to start with a bank balance column and a book balance column, and then I'm going to start filling in the blanks, so to speak. So on October 31st, the bank sent me a bank statement with certain information on it. And then, of course, I've got my books out. I've got my T account or my general ledger out. And I'm looking at what I'm showing on October 31st was the balance. And that's going to be my starting point. So it says here that the checking account, the book balance for the checking account on October 31st was $57.18. So that is the book balance, isn't it? I mean, it said the book balance is $57.18. Came right from our general ledger. But then it says the bank statement shows an ending balance of 5217. Well, right off the bat, we see, okay, then we've got some items that need to be taken care of because they're not the same balance, are they? Which one is right is what our ultimate question is. Who's right, who's wrong? But it's really not going to be either one, probably. It's going to be somewhere in between. We're going to reconcile. We're going to make it one balance, the same balance, by making adjustments to both sides. So they go on and tell you that comparing all these things, we have discovered the following items. And the first thing they talk about is we've got two deposits in transit, October 29th and October 30th. So what does that mean, a deposit in transit? What do we say? Our balance has included those deposits. But what is it about the bank and deposits in transit? They haven't posted them yet. We may have sent them through the teller window, or we may have already sent them through our phone app, etc. But the bank hasn't, as of the day that they cut that statement or printed it, these particular transactions had not posted by October 31st. So we had two. One was on October 29th, deposits in transit. October 29th for $210, and on October the 30th for $406. We add those to the bank because we have taken them to the bank. They just haven't reflected them yet in this October 31st balance. They haven't been added in yet, so we're going to do it for them, so to speak. And not that we have any control over the bank's books or their balances. We're just trying to figure out, again, where these differences are. Okay, the next thing the problem starts listing are outstanding checks. An outstanding check is one that we have written and deducted over here on the book side, but the bank doesn't know about them yet because maybe they're still stuck in somebody's mail somewhere. Okay, but we still need to deduct them from this balance so that we can figure out other discrepancies that we might have. So we had four outstanding checks, $1635, $1639, $1641, and $1653. Those are the check numbers. And we need to deduct every one of those checks from this 5217 bank balance, and it was for 5640, the first one, 175 for the next check, 13550 for check number 1641, and 44310 for check number 1653. So I've got two deposits that they aren't reflecting. I've got four checks that they haven't deducted yet. And from having done this problem many, many times in the past, I know there are no bank errors. If I were to go through all the rest of the information, the bank didn't make any kind of errors in this problem. So there's only three things that we ever adjust the bank's balance for. We add or subtract deposits in transit or outstanding checks, and any bank errors. Well, we don't have any. So this is it. I'm done accounting for everything that we need to adjust the bank's balance for. So I start with 5217, starting with the October 31st balance that they're reflecting. I'm going to add 210 plus 406, and then I'm going to subtract 5640, 175, 13550, and 44310. And I'm going to cheat and look at the figure. The adjusted bank balance at October 31st is $5,023. Okay? So any questions on what figures affect the bank as far as what is it that we need to start looking for in the bank to make sure that they accurately reported to us? And it's only, like I said, three things: deposits in transit, outstanding checks, or bank errors, and there's no bank errors in this class. Okay, so all the rest of the information that they start telling us affect what balance? The books, right? Especially once we start reading them. Because it says we have an unrecorded, and I forgot to mention this one on the previous page, an unrecorded ATM withdrawal. You got to think in your head, what's going on here? Well, more than likely, we have a bookkeeper or an accountant that's in charge of recording all the checks, all the deposits, et cetera, et cetera. But we've got a business owner that he or she may be completely different from the accountant, and usually they are, and that person has got a debit card in their wallet. What does a debit card do? If you use a debit card, what does it do to your bank account? Makes it go up or makes it go down? Makes it go down. And I don't want to use that. I don't want you to get into the debit word in that transaction, but basically what a debit card is just a fast way for you to swap it, and without writing a check, they're going to deduct money from your bank account. So the owner's got this ATM card, got this debit card in their wallet, and they went over there to the local ATM and took out $200 and didn't tell the accountant. So what's going to happen at the end of the month? Our balance right here fails to acknowledge the fact that our owner went to the ATM and took some money out. So our balance is not accurate, is it? Because there's something that happened that we didn't know about until just now. So we need to start adding or subtracting these things that we find out. So we need to subtract unrecorded ATM withdrawal. I'm going to abbreviate. And they took out $200 without our knowledge. And so now we need to reflect the fact that our balance isn't $5718. It's really that immediately minus $200 because we just now found out about it. Okay? So that takes care of the unrecorded ATM withdrawal. The next one says, well, there is also a bank service charge of $37. And again, we're not going online and checking for this kind of stuff. So we literally just discovered this when we opened up the bank statement. What do we need to do with that service charge? Add or subtract it to the book's balance? Subtract it. Less a bank service charge. $37. Then it says there was an NSF check for $476. And in this book, or in this discussion, when you see that phrase NSF check, they're referring to the fact that we had a customer that paid us $476 on their bill, and we deposited it, but yet it bounced. The customer didn't have any money. So the bank's going to take it back away from us, aren't they? They're not going to let us keep that $476. They're going to make us, they're going to take it back away from us. And then if we want that $476 again, we're going to have to go and hunt down the customer, aren't we? So we're going to subtract NSF check from customer for $476. Okay, so those are just three outright things. When we opened it up, they immediately told us outright this is what's happened. And then they give you some information. They say error on check number 1624. And I want you to think about this one. Errors are where it will always mess you up because you don't interpret correctly what they're saying. It says that the checkbook, well, what is the checkbook? The book. The checkbook. The place where we've been recording the transactions, the journal, then posted to the ledger. And it says, in the books, we show check number 1624. We show it was for $75. But the bank paid it what it was actually written for, which was 57. Well, how could that be? How could the check be written for 57, but we recorded it as 75? We just messed up, didn't we? We literally filled out the check for $57, gave it to the vendor or whoever it was that we were buying supplies from, and then we went back to our records, and when we were inputting that check into our accounting system, we recorded it as 75, but we wrote it for 57. What is the bank going to pay it as? 57. The bank cannot read our mind, number one. Number two, they are required by law to pay what the check is written for. They have no idea what you intended to write the check for. So they paid it for 57, but we had recorded it in our balance up here for 57.18. So what do I need to do with that amount, the difference between the two? Add or subtract it to the bank, the book. Okay, think again. Say that it's confusing. The checkbook, we wrote it in the checkbook. We recorded it in our accounting records for 75. The bank paid it for 57. We need to add book error. We wrote it for 75. The bank paid it for 57. The difference between that is what, 18? 15 minus 7 is 8. I think that's 18. So I need to add $18 over here because I basically deducted too much in my T account, and the bank only took away $57 from me. So again, those will be the ones that will trip you up if interpreting what they're saying. And that ends the information that they give you. So now I need to go through here and start with 5718, subtract 200, subtract 37, subtract 476, add that $18 error, and hopefully it equals 5023. I'm going to do that real fast just to make sure I didn't transpose anything. It works? Yep. So, that is what we call a reconciled bank statement. And of course, you don't see the bank statement there. This is just my work behind the reconciliation. How did I go from the bank having 5217 and us having 5718 and come up with a figure that was the same once I made the appropriate adjustments? And that's again by following the rules of reconciliation. We've got to account for the unknowns at the bank that they just didn't know about when they printed this, and then we've got to account for the things that we didn't know until we opened this. Okay? And they take practice. They just really do. But hopefully when you get to the homework, it's not set up side by side like this, I think. If I remember correctly, they kind of have you setting it up as far as question and answer is concerned, more like 5A. They gave you kind of a picture here, and they start you off at the top with a bank and you make all the adjustments, and then you go to the book and make all the adjustments, so it's more of an up and down thing. And these columns that you'll see in your homework and in the book have nothing to do with debits and credits. It's just a columns in accounting. Sometimes when we back up to the left-hand column, or back up one column to the left as we're preparing something, it's only because we're adding or subtracting more than one thing. It's It's just a more of a tool, not a, it doesn't reflect debits and credits at all. So again, hopefully you've had an opportunity to read about the bank reconciliation, but if you have not, this is kind of a good little introduction for you. Any questions on
that? The test is pretty much just break the test. There's not reconciliation to do or a lot of.
Well, there's going to be. Yeah, there is going to be a reconciliation on there. It's just not going to look like what I've done right here. It'll be set up in a little bit different format, and you'll kind of fill in the blanks as you go. It's going to lead you to, what do I need to add to the bank? Well, you're going to only add what? Deposits in transit. Okay, then the last part of Chapter 7 deals with another cash account that we haven't talked about so far in this class. It's called petty cash. If you're familiar with that phrase at all, it's just another form of cash. It's an asset. Excuse me. Just like cash. Cash is an asset, and it's literally in a bank account somewhere. That's what we're referring to when we use the, when we talked about the T account here for cash. Really, the name on your T account should be cash in the bank or cash account number, so and so and so and so. That's what we mean by just the short phrase cash. As far as the T account, it's actually in a bank account somewhere. But this asset, petty cash, is literally physical cash that we're holding in a box, a lockbox, or a safe or something.
Cash in hand.
Cash in hand, physical cash, coins, bills, etc., in our hand that is available for small and incidental expenses, because we don't want to have to write a check to the postman for 37 cents if we get a piece of mail and there's not sufficient postage on it. You know, we don't want to deal with that. And so petty cash is a way for us to use small amounts of cash to cover, again, those incidental costs that we don't necessarily want to write a check for. Or we need to send you know, John or Jane up to Dollar General to buy some paper towels for the bathroom. And we don't want to give them a check because they can't sign it. And the, you know, Dollar General's not going to take it from them anyway. So we give them a little bit of cash, and we ask them to bring back the paper towels and what else? What do you think? A receipt. So that we can balance petty cash funds. So there's some theory behind petty cash, and how do we get it onto our accounting records? Because we want to account for it. Because after a year of time of using petty cash, all of those expenditures can be substantial enough that we definitely want to take it as a business expense on our tax return.
Left hand of the balance sheet up the top.
Right.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. Yeah, it's on the balance sheet, and it should be right underneath cash in the bank. In fact, it should be really above cash in the bank because it's already cash. It is literally physical cash. And so, again, let's just talk about the theory behind it. We've got a box out here somewhere, and we've got physical cash in this drawer or this box. And when we establish this, we decide how much do we want to put in that box. Because another key point is we want to keep track of what's going in and out of this box. And so we're going to create a journal entry to establish a petty cash fund. And petty cash is an asset. How do assets increase? With debits or credits?
Debits.
So I'm going to debit. I'm going to go to the bank, and I'm going to take a check with me, and I'm going to cash it for, say, $100. And I'm going to then come back and bring that $100 and put it into the drawer here. So I need to debit petty cash for $100 to establish the fact that there's a box out there somewhere, and it's got $100 in it. And we just said I went and cashed a check. And when I say cash a check, then I mean I used this bank account right here, this cash in the bank. I wrote a check off of it, and so I just did what to that account? I increased it or decreased it when I wrote a check off of it?
Decreased it.
Yeah, and cash on for our records, cash decreases with
credit.
So I will credit cash for 100. So that's your establishing entry to create petty cash. We need to simply just move one asset from one account and put it into another asset account. Okay? So now, at all times on my balance sheet, I will see petty cash with $100 in it. And unless I change it, it should stay at that amount. Cash, of course, that will change daily depending on if I'm writing checks or making deposits. But how am I going to account then for the fact that I may put $100 in this account on January 1st, but if I'm actually using it in the business, it's not going to take long to use up $100, is it? And the whole goal is to keep $100 on hand, so we do what we call, this is the entry to establish petty cash. Now, let's look at the entry to replenish it. In other words, now it's the, this was on January the 1st, and let's say now it's January the 31st. And I went to my drawer, I'm the accountant, I went up and counted my petty cash, and lo and behold, I no longer have $100, I have $10. So I just want to make sure that, you know, I've got $100 on hand for February, don't I? So how am I going to get $90 more back into that drawer? I want to look at that side first. What am I going to do to get 90 bucks? I'm going to go and steal it.
You're going to make a withdrawal?
Yeah, I'm going to go write another check, aren't I? And I'm going to take it from the checking account. So I'm just going to save my place down here, and I'm going to go to the bank and cash a check for $90. So I'm going to credit cash for $90. Well, I'm short some debits here, aren't I? What was I doing with this petty cash store all month long? What was I using it for?
Expenses.
What?
Maybe.
Yeah, I mean, just incidentals, right? So every time, what we just talked about a second ago, every time... Camp has been calling me all day long. I don't know why. All month long, I've been using this $100 or money out of this drawer to pay for postage and to pay for supplies and fuel, etc. And I take the cash out and I give it to whomever it was that, you know, needed to go and say buy the paper towels. And they had to bring me back. We already said they had to bring me back a receipt. So every time they come back with change and a receipt, I put that back in the drawer, don't I? So the theory is at all times my cash plus receipts equals, in this case, $100. Agreed? That if you're doing it correctly and you're handling it correctly, you should always have some amount of cash and a stack of receipts, but they should all times total the original amount that we established, which was $100 in this case. So then at the end of the month, I'm going to take my receipts out, add them up, put them in different categories for postage, fuel, supplies, etc. And I'm going to write this check for $90, record those expenses, and then put those receipts back to now a paid bill file. I've taken care of that. Those receipts have been, quote, replenished with cash again. But they are legitimate business receipts, and they need to be kept. The IRS does not accept every time that you go and cash a check at the bank, you can't just call it petty cash and expect that to be a legitimate business expense. Why not? Because what can somebody do with cash?
Anything.
You can go to Whataburger, or you can go to Sonic, or, you know, you can go buy cigarettes, you know, whatever you want to do with it. And those aren't legitimate business expenses. Now, meals on occasion are, but that's not what I'm referring to here. I'm just talking about, you don't just use cash and not have a business receipt for it. So let's say that I have, for my receipts after the end of January, my receipts totaled let's say $30 for supplies, $20 for postage, and then we reimburse some fuel for $40. So those are my receipts, and they total, what, $90. And that's what I should have had, right? I've got $90 in receipts, and then I've got $10 in cash, with 90 plus 10. 100. I've accounted for that. So now I'm going to go and cash my check for 90. I'm going to debit supply expense. I'm going to debit fuel expense. And I'm going to debit postage expense. For all the things that I use this $90 for, so 30 plus 40 plus 20 is 90. And that's my replenishment entry. In the replenishment entry, one obvious thing did not get debited or credited. And what is it? What do you see here when we established it that you don't see here when we replenished it?
The account petty cash.
The account petty cash. You just don't do it. The book talks to you about the fact that you never debit or credit petty cash after establishing it, unless you permanently decrease it or you permanently increase it. Because the key is we need to record the expenses and put more cash in the drawer. Now, what if we miscount and we gave somebody back the wrong amount of change? And let's say that right now I've only got $29 in supply receipts. So my receipts only totaled 89 and my cash was still just 10, I'm off a dollar, aren't I? And so we always do what I call it plugging the account cash over or short to whatever I need to balance my journal entry. So I've got 29, 40, and 20. That's $89, but I've got a credit. I've got to get $90 back in the drawer, regardless of what my receipts add up to be. So I'm short $1 in a debit. Or not. So I'm going to debit an account called cash short or over for $1. And that takes care of any miscalculations I had or miscounting of funds back and forth. So once you read this section and attempt some of the problems, it will probably come a little bit more clear to you. Keeping in mind that another good theory about petty cash is the fact that one person should be in charge. Why is that? What?
The same person shouldn't be in charge of multiple things. Like they should make the receipt and take the cash because that can absolutely lead to problems.
Yeah, you're talking about separation of duties, and I think that's actually talked about in the book, that we shouldn't have one person doing everything. But as far as petty cash, we do only want to have one person with accessibility to it, because we don't want everybody's hands in the petty cash drawer, do we? Because it would never be done accurately. If one person is in charge, then that one person is responsible, and I guarantee you they're not going to let it slide for somebody else to come in and take money and then be held responsible for it. Does that make sense? Okay, well, we're out of time, so if you have questions when you're doing your homework and stuff, be sure and email me. No guarantee I'll respond later in the day, but I'll get back to you first thing in the morning, usually. So, any questions on Chapter 7 so far? Okay, well, you'll have a good Monday.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty outside. This has been an unbelievable fall so far. I just jinxed it. Tomorrow will snow. Or be 100, one or the other. Did you have any questions, Annabelle? Always hate to, I know that it's hard for you to interject.
No, ma'am. Trini will be helping me a lot.
Okay, good.
So, he gets with me, and if I have any questions, he helps me a lot. So,
okay.
Tomorrow we'll be getting together.
Perfect. Yeah, he's really good, so take advantage of that.
Okay, thank you. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you.